And we're back for some more Steve Jackson Sorcery, the interactive Let's Play that lets you decide the outcome. I'm not completely sure, but the majority of you guys decided to have me go inside. You approach the old woman. She smiles a toothless smile and gets up from the step. "Come in, please," she beckons. "I get so lonely, living out here on my own, away from the villages. Now our stamina is low. We have one ration. Maybe she'll give us rations. Maybe we can rest up. It would be great. Maybe she'll attack or curse us, which would not be so great. And also I noticed at some point we changed from baboon into gorilla. It seems like a good thing. Gorillas are a little stronger than baboons, right? So I believe it was 3-2. Go inside. So here we go. Hope you guys didn't just kill me. Thank you. You follow her inside and take a seat by a long wooden table. "I'll bring us some tea," she says. She sounds almost nervous. Something's up. Hurrying to her kitchen, she returns with two large cups. "Watch it," Jan whispers in your ear. "I don't trust this one. Not that I care what happens to you, of course." Touching. Real touching. Now, the other thing to remember is with Jan around, he's a mini-mite. He's like a little, like, pixie sprite little guy. Our magic doesn't work, which is great. Hopefully this will work. Calling on our deity. Before I drink anything, drink out of her cup. Let's make conversation. I'm a little hesitant here. The tea is still hot. You cup it between your hands as you speak. "What's your name?" "They call me Gaza Moon," she replies with a smile. "I used to be quite well known in my way." You nod, but you have never heard of her. "Why do you live alone?" "It must be more dangerous." "Oh," she smiles sweetly. "No one bothers about me. Why would they?" You can't help but notice she has not answered the question. "This is a beautiful place." I'm really stalling at this point. You remark, watching the river outside the door plunging away over the cliff face. "This is the top of the crystal waterfall," she says. "The river runs right under my house. They say it carries all my goodness and youth away while I sleep, and the villagers bathe in it for luck." She giggles, meanly. "I'm sure it isn't quite true." You make to sip your tea when the old woman stops you, catching your arm before the cup reaches your lips. "Oh," she says suddenly, "I've forgotten the pot." She goes back to the kitchen to fetch it. I'm switching cups with her. Why does she not want us to drink the tea yet, though? What final preparation has to be made? I'm going to switch cups with her. While she is away from the table, you switch the two cups around. When she returns, you lift the one closest to you and drink. A sudden deep pain grips your stomach and you double over. Both of them are poisoned. Aura has iocane powder, and over the years she's developed an immunity to iocane powder. Let's see if anyone else gets the reference. What's happening? You wince and cough as you find yourself seizing up. "Ho, suspicious stranger," laughs the woman. "I can count on travelers suspecting my witchcraft."
Oh, God.
Sorry, guys. I put my hand on my mouth. Please, release me. You try to shout out, but you are paralyzed and quite powerless. The old woman begins to search through your bag. Jan watches, arms folded, doing nothing but clearly not surprised. "Jan, you're no help at all." Then with a coup of delight, she pulls out the spellbook page you were given by the old man in the tree. "My book," she cries. "The missing page. Why didn't you tell me you had my missing spell?" First I would have to know it's yours. She scurries off into the kitchen and returns with a cup of liquid, which she pours into your half-open mouth while clucking and stroking your head. It is an antidote, and you feel your body slowly unfreeze. Finally, she slaps you to bring you around. What is the spell? You ask. It's a spell of pest repulsion. You have no idea how useful it is around here. Oh, for Jan? She shakes her head. 4 days ago, I was visited by a traveler such as yourself. But when I was away making my tea, as I always do, he started leafing through my book and tore out a page. He must have been a wizard of power, because he vanished almost too fast for me to curse him. What curse did you cast? To make him old? Well, you saw him, she replies. I aged him. Didn't stop him escaping, though. She fusses with the page, repairing her spellbook with some gentle magic. Shall I show you how useful the spell is? She says. She's going to get rid of Jan, isn't she? Which I actually don't mind that much, because then we can use our magic again. But I want to see what she means. Well, she makes a little gesture at something behind you. How can I put this? You're sure you don't want me to rid you of a pest? And you realize she's looking at Jan. I don't want to harm the guy. Is he going to just chase him off, or is he going to kill him? Non-committal. I have no pests. No, she agrees with some disgust. You seem rather clean. She gets to her feet. You'd best be going. Okay. Jan hops onto your shoulder, whispering profuse thanks into your ear, and you leave. Well, I guess it could have gone worse. Now we can only go outside the village. We need to rest and stuff. It is now late afternoon. You pass over the brow of the next hill, and below you is the village of Torapani, slung from one side of the valley to the next like a flood barrier. Let's observe it. Torapani is a village of the Sfin, an aggressive-looking race of man-orcs. You might expect their village to be rowdy, but it seems strangely quiet. Unfortunately, guys, we have no choice but to go into the town of man-orcs. Wait. There isn't a way, like, I can rest here. It's all the keys we have. Copper key. We have a giant net. Pretty cool. Well, hopefully these guys are friendly. We need rations and we need rest. And hopefully what we don't find is fight and death. Still, there is no way around it. You will have to go through. Torapani, here we come. You enter the village. There is a definite air of depression hanging over the place. The Savins are going about their business slowly and miserably and pay you no heed. You sit yourself down on a tree stump in the very center of the village to consider your options. Let's find an inn to rest. We really need rest. There are 3 inns in the village, but 2 are closed down, their windows boarded and their thatched roofs rotting through. The 3rd looks a little better, but at least its door is open and the smell of well-cooked food drifts out. From a sign by the doorway, it seems that food costs 3 gold pieces and a bed for the night costs 5. I would actually pay for both at this point. Let's go inside. You push open the door and step into the dim interior. A rat scurries over your foot and disappears into a corner. An elderly Sfin lady, bent double, stands by the counter, tapping a long, curved fingernail on the bar top. "What do you want?" she snaps. Woman bored. You count out 8 gold pieces. 8? I thought it was 5 for both together. Damn it. "Room and a meal," you reply. "I've come a long way." The Sphinx nods twice and takes your payment. "The meal is a rat broth. If that's not good enough for you, you can lower your hopes. The room's upstairs. I'll bring your food to you." She jerks a fingernail up towards the stairs. You go up and unstrap your pack and loosen your boots while you wait. The meal, when it comes, is nourishing, and you bolt it down. Then you stretch back on the bed. The night closes in, and the room has no candles. Then you hear footsteps on the staircase outside. I'm gonna take position by the doorway. You move quickly out of bed and take position behind the doorway, sword at the ready. Footstep after footstep approaches. There are quite a few of them, and by the sound they're big. The door begins to open. Let's wait a moment longer. Is... what's his name still with us? So we don't have much stamina anyway. You wait a moment longer, your breath short and shallow, hoping they will not notice that you are waiting. The first Vin enters the room, followed by another, then a third and a fourth, then a fifth and a sixth. Before you can move, you are overpowered, the creatures grabbing at your ankles and arms until you are hoisted up. They carry you bodily out of the door, down the stairs, bumping and bruising past the cackling landlady who shrieks, "That's the one! I knew it when I saw her!" and out into the cold street. Jan clings onto your shoulder, refusing to be shaken free. So that's our answer to our question there. Jan is still with us. Should I pray to the spirit for aid? Will we get another chance? Let's pray. In a whisper, you give a prayer to your spirit, the baboon, for aid. Hey, it was a gorilla. Nothing happens immediately. Then you reach a low hut and are thrown to the earth. Your arms and legs are released. Perhaps your spirit has heard you. You cannot be sure. But now that you have summoned the powers above, they will not help you again. Oh. So I have to move into captured? Can I just go somewhere else? The door is slammed and locked. A moment later it reopens and your possessions are thrown inside. I should try to sleep or gain stamina. A few more minutes pass with no more movement. Figuring they will probably now wait until daylight, you put your head down to sleep. Your dreams are filled with grasping hands and long dark nails scratching at your flesh, and however much you toss and turn on the floor, you cannot quite get them out of your mind. Daybreak. I'm not literally traveling, I'm just like going to... It's like the passage of time. Daybreak. You are still alone. An hour passes before you hear any noise outside. And then the door to the hut opens and five Sphinx come in. They drag you roughly out and across the street to another hut where an old man with gray hair sits. He is wearing outlandish, colorful robes.
"My name Proteus, chief."
He slaps his chest twice.
"I apologize."
And he bows, brushing the dust on the floor with his sleeves. Let's be polite. Apology accepted. The chief nods. He waves to a menial who brings in bread and milk. I'm gonna eat it. Cool. Gratefully, you bolt down the meal. It does not seem to be poisoned, and it nourishes you. The bowl is removed, and the chief squats down in a pool of cloth. Jan cowers under your own cloak, hoping to go unnoticed and quiet for once.
"I have need of you and your strength."
"I will kill you."
Tell me.
The chief nods.
"I shall. My daughter, my child, she is taken, offered to a terrible demon below."
"You want me to rescue her?" The chief nods.
"Succeed, and you may choose your reward. Fail, and..."
He shrugs. "Okay. I'll do it." The chief nods.
"I hope you will."
He gestures to the other Sphinx, who, still taking no chances, grab you by your arms and haul you to your feet. Well, this is pretty interesting. And I guess we're going to a crack in the ground. Can I at least rest some more? You are led along a short pathway through the forest to a crack in the ground. One Sphinx has brought a rope and another a basket. They are preparing to lower you down into the pit of the earth itself. Hopefully we don't die horribly. I'm gonna take the adventure. You wait until they are ready, then step into the basket. The chief nods to you with respect. Watch the darkness, he declares as they start to lower you down. From your shoulder, Jan murmurs, we're in trouble now, he shivers. You hit the floor with a thud and peer into the darkness. Your eyes can make out nothing, but a slight breeze suggests endless space in all directions. You are blind, helpless, trapped. Something clatters to your feet from above. One of the Sphinx shouts something down to you. Now, what made trying to escape or going down to the pit, I would have made that a choice, but that would have resulted in like a 16-minute video. Unfortunately, the best choices keep probably going to end up in the middle of the video, unfortunately. Feel around on the ground for whatever they threw. You crouch down and feel around your feet until your hand closes on the base of something. You pick it up. It is a dry wood torch. Something else falls from above and strikes you on the head. Tinderbox, calls the voice. Feel around for the tinderbox. Rubbing the bruise on your head, you reach down and find the tinderbox. Cursing isn't going to achieve anything. Light the torch. You strike a light, and the torch blazes into flame. Below. Time to meet the master below. You can see now you are in a large cavern, wide and deep. At the far end, passageways disappear to the left and right. Through an uneven rockfall at the far end of the cavern, you hear a murmur. Let's listen by the rocks. You clamber over the rocks at the edge of the cavern to investigate the sound. It's a whimpering coming from the other side of the pile of stones. The Sphinx girl, perhaps? She came in this way, but then the cave-in blocked off her path. You will have to find another way to reach her. Go right? You turn right, creeping slowly forward. The passageway slopes down a short way, then ends in a T-junction. Two stones are stacked on top of one another against the wall here. Let's examine the stones. There's nothing special about the two stones, except that they happen to be on top of one another. Continuing going right. You take the right-hand tunnel. The tunnel twists and bends sharply, as if carved by a river now long since dried away. You lose all sense of which way is which, except to keep going forward, where the tunnel splits. There's a stacked pair of stones here as well. I say keep going right. You move through the opening in the right wall. The going is suddenly more difficult, and you realize that the tunnel is climbing at quite a sharp gradient. Little stones rattle and roll away downwards into the dark. At the highest point, the passage you are following finishes at another fork. As you enter, two stones roll away down the slope. I don't know if you guys can hear this in the background. You're barely audible. It sounds like my heartbeat. Or a heartbeat. I wasn't aware of it until just now. Let's keep going right. You go right. The cave walls crush in close, as though the rock is squeezing you to death. Your shoulders rub against the walls. When you feel certain you can go no further, the path you are creeping through forks again. Another pair of stones are stacked in one corner.
Right?
You follow the passageway when you hear an echo of whimpering coming up the corridor. Your torchlight falls along a frail shape. Hiding in the darkness is the young Sfin girl, stacking stones into hundreds of little towers. Let's look for traps. You run the torchlight around the walls of the cavern. No switches or triggers that you can see. The girl watches you with silent fear. And then the torchlight falls on a deep scratch in the rock, a claw mark. Suddenly there is a loud roaring from the mouth of this short cavern. The walls begin to shake and crumble. The Sfin's stone towers topple and scatter. To one side, a gap in the rubble begins to open, letting through a mean shaft of light. But before you can head for it, the roaring sound is joined by a scream from the Sfin girl. You turn slowly and peer into the gloom back along the tunnel. Is there something moving? Something coming closer? Perhaps the roaring is the wind rushing through the tunnels.
Grab the girl and run, that's what I say. Something is coming. The heartbeat is louder now. Can I, not go towards something is coming? I'll be let off into the barrier here. We're gonna die. You hear the scrabbling sound of claws on rock. And the exit from the tunnel is blocked by a dark and looming shape, a manticore. Huge, terrible. It stands between you and the light and howls in bloody rage. I don't want to fight it.
Using magic will not work. Look at the creature. Oh, maybe I should have got rid of this thing, this Jan.
The manticore is a foul hybrid created by the evil sorcerers of old and steeped in bitter self-hatred. It has a lion's body and the tail of a scorpion, but its face is that of an old man, and its thoughts are cruel and resentful. As it sees you, it rears back, flapping two enormous wings on its back. Now, we only have 10 stamina, just half of what we could have had. You draw your sword and close on the beast, eyes focused tightly on the terrible sting. A little cautious jab. Oh my. The fearsome creature paces forward, teeth bared. You sidestep quickly and slash out sideways and low with your sword. At the last moment, the manticore pounces, all claws off the ground and bared to plunge into your flesh. You brace yourself as it comes down and leap aside at the last moment, claws raking your skin. Yeah, I don't think we have a chance here, guys. The creature snarls and snaps its jaws. You must finish this monster before it finishes you. With the rock wall at your back, you have no way to hide, but a perfect platform to spring forward. You race at the manticore just as it swings its tail down like a hammer stroke. As it rears, you push your sword up into its exposed belly. You have opened a deep wound in its side. The Sfin girl cheers. The manticore shifts away and opens its wide jaws, which look so human, but contain an impossible number of teeth, each one dripping a mixture of saliva and blood. Okay. You should go see a dentist. Standing firm, you swing a mighty stroke against the monster, catching the manticore a light blow. Again? Nope, he won this one. The manticore moves quickly and strikes so fast with its scorpion sting that you barely see it move and have only a single heartbeat to react. Your own attack is forgotten as you try to regain your balance. The beast growls at you. The walls shiver with its fury. The Sfin girl edges nearer as if thinking of scratching the creature with her claws. "It's scared," she whispers to you. "You might not believe me, but you've scared it."
Really? All I can do is side swipe, jab, or defend.
In the darkness of the cave, it is hard to read the monster's intentions, but you cannot wait forever. Sidestepping, you slash out at the manticore,
slipping a light strike past its outstretched claws. It curses you in an almost human tongue. Oh, damn it. The creature whips out with its vicious tail. You defend yourself as best as you can. You are gasping for breath. The creature's relentless assault, its sheer rage, is almost too much for you to take. The manticore chomps and grinds its teeth, its expression an ugly frown. Jab. And I'll die soon. The monster pounds across the stone floor, knocking you over. You parry swiftly. You look quickly over your shoulder, considering escape, but there is nothing but solid rock. You are standing in your grave. From the other side of the chamber, the Sphin girl picks up a rock and hurls it at the manticore's head. But it serves only to make the creature more angry. This could be the end, guys. Yeah. Your enemy acts fast and whips its sting so sharply that you have only an instant to evade. The Sphin girl screams. Only then do you see the giant sting plunging down towards your forehead. In your weakened state, you are too slow to roll out of the way. The sting lands with the force of a hammer blow, piercing your skull. The last thing you feel is a thumping of burning poison as it enters your brain. What's my fate? You've been killed in combat. Alright. Can I rewind even more? No. I want to take my ration. I'm going to try a couple more times anyway. Oh, goddamn. The fearsome creature paces forward, its teeth bared. You drop back, raising your guard, hoping the beast will wear itself out. At the last moment, the manticore pounces, all claws off the ground and bared to plunge into your flesh. You brace yourself as it comes down and leap aside at the last moment, claws raking your skin. For a moment, it is close enough to smell its warm, fetid breath. Boom. Okay. The monster pounds across the stone floor, knocking you over. You defend yourself as best as you can. Charging forward, you rush into the manticore at the same moment as it comes for you with its horrible sting. You cut into it like a butcher. The manticore laughs at you with a human expression of twisted joy. You risk an attack. Standing firm, you swing a mighty stroke against the monster, catching the manticore a light blow. I feel like we should defend. You spy an advantage, the kind that can change the course of a battle. Racing across the stone, you charge headlong towards the manticore, slipping a light strike past its outstretched claws. It curses you in an almost human tongue. This is really... The creature whips out with its vicious tail. Your own attack is forgotten as you try to regain your balance. Blood trickles over the hilt of your sword, making it slippery. The monster rears up onto its back legs and opens its wings to fill the room. Should I defend? Warily, you move into a defensive crouch. The manticore stays low and tries to ram you. You stagger back. The back of the gigantic sting knocking you across the cave room. The Sphin girl was shaking with fear. You know she has seen heroes defeated before. Ah, that didn't work out for me. Nope. Standing firm, you swing a fearsome stroke against the monster, catching the manticore a passing cut. The creature crashes against one wall. Rock dust pours onto its back, but as it tries to shake itself, it stumbles. You can hardly dare to hope. The foul beast is weakening. Unfortunately, we only have 1 point. Yeah, that's it. Down to 5. Charging forward, you rush into the manticore, landing a quick jab past its tail. The sting of its tail begins to leak a foul-smelling green ooze. Now, if we defend, it will almost certainly attack and take 1 point off of us, which will kill us. Nope. Bellowing, you race at the manticore just as it charges you. You catch it rearing up and exposed. You have opened a deep wound in its side. The Sphin Girl cheers. The manticore gnashes its jaws, readying itself for the taste of your bones. Go for its throat, the Sphin Girl cries out. I can only give it a sideswipe to its throat. Oh my god. Back against the rock, you deliver a ferocious stab at the foul creature. Landing a quick jab past the manticore's tail. The manticore screams and howls in a voice that is almost human. It is dying. Slowly, furiously, but nonetheless, it weakens. Damn it! Yep, burning poison in my brain. We did it. Ha! Huh. Standing firm, you swing a fearsome stroke against the monster. Your sword blade seems almost to be possessed. It finds its way past the manticore's sweeping claws, through its thick hide, and down into its ancient, cruel heart. For a moment, it howls loud enough to make the wall shake, and then everything falls very quiet. 8 stamina lost. Decent dueling. Thank you. What I ended up doing is, well, defending for the first time, because it has that strong charge, and its charge is pretty strong to begin with, so you want to defend, and then the second time, I actually charge forward, which is like the most powerful blow you can do. And then I did a side swipe, then I defended, and I think then that I did a side swipe, defended, I cut, I defended, I cut, I defended, I cut, defended, and then once he said, you know, for it to, you know, strike at its throat, I don't think I had charge available. I had lunge or something like that, the second strongest attack. And I happened to not take as so much damage that way. It's just with 10 points, it's kind of difficult. The only noise in the chamber is the hammering of your heart and the quiet breathing of the Sphin Girl. Then the Minimite breaks out into a large cheer, whooping and punching the air. You bow to him. Thank you, the Sphin Girl murmurs, then tugging at your arm this way. She leads you towards the light, through a gap in the rock, to the pool of sunlight in the first cavern. I can't find anything. Let's just get out of here, please. You wave the torch, hoping to attract attention. Tell the girl to call out. Girl, call to your father. The Sphin Girl nods mutely, then bawls at the top of her lungs. Proteus, I'm here! Then something drops down, a rope, with a basket on the end. Get in together, the chief calls from above. We'll pull you both in. We'll pull you both up. Get in. You step into the basket and help the girl to clamber in with you. Ready? I don't trust them. If I just send the girl out by herself to be like, okay, thanks, bye. The fins above you begin to haul. The rope stretches and grows taut, but the basket doesn't move. The rope starts to make a squealing noise, and the basket lifts a finger width off the floor. Let's get out and let the girl go first. Haul away. You step out of the basket and call up. The fins give a great cry and begin to pull again, and this time the basket starts to slowly rise, spinning as it goes. The girl waves to you as she disappears up in the sunlight. Then she is gone. And, wait. A minute pauses. Nothing. Call up. Throw down the rope. Oh, God. Nothing. The tunnel echoes very slightly, a noise from its depths. Perhaps the Manticore was not alone. I'm climbing because I can't find anything else. They have abandoned you, left you, your fate, disagreeable creatures. Their promise of gifts and rewards were all hollow. Setting down the torch, you begin to try, and scale the rocky walls. It's a long and difficult climb, and you are tired. You cannot expect to make it, but you have no choice. But then a shadow falls across the entrance. Are they sealing it up? No! No. Something falls. The rope and the basket. You clamber quickly in, and they haul you up. Above ground, the chief himself helps you out onto his grass. Onto the grass, sorry. His daughter is with him, clutching his hand. I was a little frightened there, guys. My daughter tells you fight bravely, he says. For that I am grateful. I invite you with us back to Torapani. Will you come? Yes. I still hear my heartbeat. Is that because I'm low on stamina? A little generosity cannot hurt you. You nod. I will come. As you enter the village, it erupts into celebration. You are given a place to stay and recuperate from your long journey. A visit to the healing priest. Yes! Oh, I'm so happy now, guys. Now I just need to buy some rations. These guys need to give me gold. Anyway, it's a visit to the healing priest, treats your wounds, and when you emerge, it is to find the village, before so somber and silent, now in full life. Flowers are tied to every rooftop, and bands of sphins are playing music on long, strangely shaped lyres. You are whisked away into the dance by Proteus' daughter, before the chief can welcome you to the feast. The night is glorious. That night you sleep heavily, and rise the next morning to continue your journey. The chief meets you before you go. My good friend, he declares, you have saved us. He presses two gifts into your hands, a pouch of 10 gold pieces, a fortune for a place like this, and a key. This opened the south city gate of Kharé, he tells you. I hope it is use. Yeah, I think it will be use. I'm gonna go. I need some rations. You take your leave. The path winds away from Torapani, and soon you are on a downward slope away from the Shamutanti Hills, through stepped rice fields. As you walk, you feel for the first time the loneliness of the path ahead. Though Kharé is a busy city, it is cruel, and beyond Kharé there is nothing but the vicious wasteland. You will have no one to trust in the days ahead. Is our mini-mite still with us? Walk on. In the distance rises the wall of a great city, the first true stonework you have seen since the ruins of the giant city in the hills. From your shoulder you feel Jan hop away into the air. I didn't mind the Manticore, he hisses, but this place I am afraid of. Take care. You'll need it. Then he buzzes away into the sky and is gone. You're not exactly sorry to see him go, but you wonder if you will ever see him again. Yeah, I'm not sorry. I need my spells. It's kind of the cool thing about games like this. We have spells. To Kharé. Zoop. Your journey through the Shamutanti Hills is completed. Along the way, you have made no useful friendships, but have been given two useful keys to the Cell of the Red Eyes and to the Gates of Kharé. You have collected a couple of magical artifacts. Two giant's teeth. You are still armed only with your original sword, and have one ration and 18 gold pieces and a spellbook. the adventure continues. Wow, I didn't think it was this short, especially with me reading everything. So I'm gonna save. Gives you a code. Fapata. Well, there's no real choice here, guys. And I don't want to start a new game, you know, with the same episode. The crown of kings has been stolen by the Archmage and taken across the Badlands. Backlands, to Manpeng. You've been sent to get it back. Should you fail, the whole of Kakabad will surely fall. The journey began. From the outpost settlement of Annaland, you crossed the Shamutanti Hills. Along the way, you explored an abandoned city of giants, traveled with a mini-mite who almost cost you your life, and fought and killed the dreaded Manticore. You faced starvation, disease, a test of character. To survive, you used your blade rarely, and your intelligence frequently, but always acted cautiously, with honor and compassion. Your spirit guide changed as you changed, becoming the gorilla. But now all of that seems a distant memory, for you are approaching Kharé, the cityport of traps. Founded on a ford of the Jabani River, Kharé was once a camp for the pirates who were ambushed merchants, sailing from Lake Lumley to the sea. But the camp grew, it became a village, the village became a town, and now Kharé is a magnet for ne'er-do-wells and thieves, ruled over by a council of villains. It cannot be avoided. You would go around it if you could, but on the far side is the North Gate, the only entrance to the Backlands and the next stage of your journey. For the good of the kingdom, you must enter the Cityport of Traps and make it out alive. Alright guys, gonna end it off here. Extra long episode, even with that battle cut out. All my failed battles. I must have fought that Manticore battle like, I don't know, like 10 times. Thanks so much for watching, guys. There really isn't nothing to choose here. This is the next game anyway, so... I welcome your comments and your thoughts nonetheless. At least we have... I don't even see, like, our stats or anything like that. Well, something teen gold pieces, 20 stamina, and a ration. Thanks so much for watching, guys. Stay tuned for next week for the second installment. And, yeah, should be a lot of fun. Thanks for watching, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.